Okay, hi, thank you very much for the invitation. Today I'm going to discuss Ricardo's paper, Central Bank Going Long. Here are my slides. At the beginning of the discussion, I will briefly summarize Ricardo's paper, then I will provide a direction that Ricardo may follow in order to continue pushing this going long research agenda forward. So, broadly speaking, this paper does two things. First, this paper documents in detail three unconventional monetary episodes in which the Federal Reserve, the Bank of England, and the Bank of Japan, respectively, went long. Second, this paper develops a standard model of inflation dynamics to evaluate whether the going long policies that those central banks implemented helped to keep inflation on target or not. So what are these going long episodes about? According to the narrative descriptions in this paper, the Federal Reserve went long in the pre-accord period of 1942 to 1951. So basically, the Federal Reserve pegged the 90-day T-bill rate at a fixed rate, as well as established a ceiling on the 10-year bond yield. The Bank of England went long in the 1960s, following the report presented by the Radcliffe Commission. So following the advices from that commission, the Bank of England, among many other things, target the 10-year gilt yield. The Bank of Japan started going long, at least explicitly, at the very end of 2016, following the announcement of the new QQE policy framework. The current Japanese yield control policy, YCC policy, targets both the overnight central bank rate and the 10-year bond yield. So those are essentially the going long policies that Ricardo studies, and he embeds those policies into a standard model. So what is this model about? So this model is a frictionless economy in which inflation and the dynamics of inflation are endogenous. Frictionless here means that nominal prices are fully flexible and that financial markets are complete as well as free of frictions. The model is also cashless, meaning that there is no quantity of money nor money at all. In this second dimension, the model economy is very related to a new Keynesian framework. So more technically, this model economy is a continuous time dynamic stochastic general equilibrium economy in which there is a single economic agent that is a representative household. So you can think about this model as a representative agent asset pricing based model of inflation. This is a standard tool used in finance or in macrofinance nowadays. So in equilibrium, we have that inflation and the dynamics of inflation are fully determined by three conditions. What are these three conditions? The three conditions are a version of the Fisher equation, a boundary condition on expected inflation, and the policy rules that Ricardo embeds into analysis. So Ricardo only focuses on interest rate rules, and they look like a Taylor rule. We can interpret these rules as Taylor rules. So the classical dichotomy between real variables and nominal variables holds in equilibrium, which implies that the real interest rate in the version of the Fisher equation is completely independent of monetary policy and of inflation. So to solve for this model, Ricardo first solves from the real part of the model, and then uses the policy rule and the real part in order to compute the dynamics of inflation. There is also a no arbitrage condition holding in equilibrium independently of whether financial assets are issued in real or nominal terms. And this no boundary condition implies that monetary policy can only choose a single maturity in the yield curve. Put it differently, effectively, in equilibrium, monetary policy can target a single maturity in the term structure of the nominal interest rate. So I think that's quite restrictive, and then I will point out in that particular feature of the model in more detail. So what is the main message of Ricardo? So Ricardo finds that none of the three going long policies documented in this paper were successful at keeping inflation on target. So what is the logic? Through the lens of this model economy, a moderate peg on the 90-day treasury bill rate, or a binding ceiling on the 10-year bond yield, prevent monetary policy from increasing the level of the nominal interest rates in this economy. As a consequence, those policies regimes prevent monetary policy from accommodating large increases in aggregate demand and from mitigating inflationary pressures. The model economy predicts, in particular, that under those policy regimes, the economy eventually ends up in a situation in which inflation is high, and which inflation, in particular, is higher than the desired target. That indeed was the situation forecast for the US economy at the period at which the Federal Reserve decided to stop going long. So in that particular dimension, the model is very accurate. In the original version of the model economy, targeting long-term interest rates does not necessarily prevent the ability of monetary policy for keeping inflation on target. Why? Because the no arbitrage condition guarantees that there is always a long-term interest rate rule that is consistent with a specific short-term rule that keeps inflation on target. That is the application of that yield curve lemma that Ricardo showed during presentation. However, in a slightly modified version of the model economy, in which there is uncertainty concerning parameter values, targeting long-term interest rates is not a very good idea. Why? Because in equilibrium, these long-term interest rate rules depend on the parameters in the model economy in a more complex way than their short-term counterparts. So they have more elements going on. As a consequence, Ricardo concludes that going long was not very successful for the UK case either. Well, lastly, let me talk about the Japanese situation. For analyzing the Japanese going long episode, the model assumes that this yield control curve policy is free of arbitrage opportunities. So according to the model economy, and as Ricardo explained, keeping inflation on targets requires a steepening the yield curve rather than flattening. And Ricardo documents that Bank of Japan currently is actually doing the opposite, so it's flattening the yield curve in situation of low inflation. So then he concludes that the current going long policy as implemented in the Bank of Japan is not useful for keeping inflation on target either. So I think this is very interesting project. So it's a contribution in terms of unconventional monetary policy or in the literature of unconventional monetary policy by documenting in detail these three episodes in which central banks went long. It's also a contribution to a literature on inflation and the yield curve by developing this model economy in which monetary policy also affects higher orders related to inflation, such as inflation risk premium. So as noticed that in the usual discrete time environment, it's very difficult to analyze the effect of monetary policy on higher order moments related to inflation. And why? Because usually those models log linearized the equilibrium around the steady state and hence miss the higher order interactions. As I mentioned, this paper is very interesting, though there is always scope for making progress and for continuing improving. Here I will point out the direction that Ricardo may be interested in following. So I consider the frictionless economic environment very restrictive in the sense that this environment implies that monetary policy can target a single maturity in the yield curve. Why? Because of the no arbitrage condition. So in what follows, I will develop a model economy, very simple, and in which that frictionless environment will not hold anymore, and hence monetary policy will be able to target different ends of the or different maturities in the yield curve. So what is this model about? So very simple, this model builds upon the work of Karlstrom and co-author 2017 and of Alexis Abob and co-author 2017. So in this model we have, as agents, we have households, firms, financial intermediaries, and a monetary authority. So firms need to finance some working capital in advance in order to produce. In this model economy, finance, or let's say financial securities more in general, are limited to short-term debt and to long-term debt only. Financial markets are segmented in the sense that households can only participate in the short-term debt market. Firms can only participate in the long-term debt market, and financial intermediaries and the monetary authority can participate in both markets. In equilibrium, financial intermediaries cannot eliminate the term spread between the long-term debt and the short-term debt because they are subject to a leverage constraint that limits leverage by a multiple of net worth. Financial intermediaries still in equilibrium, taking levered position on long-term debt, and they do so by issuing short-term debt. And the problem with this particular strategy is that they expose themselves to aggregate withdrawal risk coming from households. Why? Because households are also using the short-term debt of financial intermediaries to settle some sort of transactions they conduct among each other. This withdrawal risk generate a demand of financial intermediaries for government bonds, in particular for short-term government bonds, because only those bonds are fully liquid. And what is the meaning of liquidity here? The meaning is that only those bonds can be sold at short value, at face value, excuse me, in short notice. So in that environment, we can devise a situation. In that environment, what happens in equilibrium is that the aggregate quantity of short-term government bonds affect the liquidity premium, if you want to, the spread between the intermediary short-term debt and the government short-term debt. At the same time, the aggregate quantity of long-term bonds, of long-term government bonds, affect the term premium. That is to say, the spread between short-term debt and long-term debt in general. In that situation, we can divide, in that environment, we can divide situations in which monetary policy controls only the term premium or the liquidity premium. And we can associate this premium with different ends in the yield curve. For instance, the liquidity premium will be more related to the short-term end and to the short-term interest rates. And the third premium will be more related to the other end of the yield curve. I think that the model in Savoy is more related to the one that Ricardo presented. Why? Because it's also in continuous time and hence it's much more easy to adapt to the framework post by Ricardo. On the other hand, the model in Kallstrom is in discrete time and hence it suffered this problem of misestimating the effects of monetary policy on moments related to inflation premium and to volatility in general. So overall, as I mentioned before, I think that in this model, we can have these two policies that target different ends of the yield curve, and hence can also provide some guidance on how to go long and on how to coordinate going long with going short. Okay, this is mainly all what I have to say regarding Ricardo's paper. As I mentioned, I think it's very good contribution, but there is also some scope in terms of pushing this going long research agenda forward.